What's going on, guys? Marcos couldn't make it out today, and we need Marcos for the koozie, but we need to produce every Sunday. So instead, I had to make some changes, and I brought my boy straight from LA, Armin Gomeshi. All right, so we're doing Hot Topics together today, so I hope you enjoy.
Yeah. So good. Oh, I'm gonna go use the bathroom, yo. We'll see.
Damn, forgot about me already.
Yeah, dude, you're not memorable, dude.
That's what happens when you leave for 5 years.
All right, where were you?
I was in LA. I was at UCLA, and then I graduated. I worked there for a year for my gap year, and then I came back right now, back to Florida to apply to med school.
Okay, what did you do during your gap year?
I had two part-time jobs. One of them was 3 days a week. The other was 2 days a week. One of the jobs, I was a medical assistant at an oncology clinic. So like all the patients had cancer, and I would like check them in, draw blood, basically do like a lot of the stuff that the doctor didn't have time to do. Okay. And then the other one, I was a research intern. That was kind of like paperwork type stuff. It wasn't that fun.
Oh, like clinical research? Or?
Clinical research, yeah.
Oh, so you weren't like pipetting?
No, I wasn't pipetting. It wasn't like that type of stuff. It was more so calling patients, trying to get people to participate, sure like everything was set for the studies. I wasn't doing anything like cool, to be honest. It was more so just like.
But you're out in LA. Dude.
Yeah, that's running. I was running the hospital, to be honest. I'm being humble. I was low key the CEO of that.
That's sick. So, yeah, where did you live?
I lived in Westwood. I lived in Westwood all 5 years.
Is that like a nice place? Like,
no. Okay, so when you go to UCLA, the first year you live in the dorms, okay. Right? And then the second and third year is kind of when students live in the apartments. And Westwood is where all the like unofficial student apartments are. It's right next to campus, like 15 minute walk, and I lived there. It was cool. Nothing like, you know, it's like normal college like apartments.
But it wasn't like a college town, right?
It's not a college town like Gainesville or like Ann Arbor. But I mean, it's mainly college students.
Okay.
But there are like non-college students there.
In your like neighborhood?
In my complex, like my neighbors were like, you get noise complaints for parties all the time from like, you know.
Oh yeah.
Parents and stuff. So I have a funny story.
Go ahead.
One time we were having like just like friends over, and then like the friends brought their friends, so it became like larger than we expected, and we had told our neighbors like, if it gets loud, just let us know, and like we'll turn down the music. That's what like that's what everyone has to do, because like they're pretty strict about it, the cops.
And it's like
it's small.
It's a small place.
It's very
right?
dense.
Like you
very
share
dense.
A room with like three people.
Yeah, no, you share a room. That's not the issue. It's more so like the walls of each unit is thin, so like you can hear everything. So like my unit wasn't a problem because like my friends were the ones who were like having the gathering. Sure. It was more so like people upstairs and downstairs, and we had a UCLA professor live upstairs, and he had just had a newborn. So like
what was he doing living in like
that's exactly with, like, what we said. And I'm just like, bro, like, why are you living here? Like, go live somewhere else.
What the
I don't know, like normal dad, 40-50.
Okay.
UCLA professor, and he was always complaining. And one time he came down to our unit, he's banging on the door, and we don't hear him, right? Because we're just like chilling. And I'm just like, what is that? We open the door, his wife storms in, goes straight to like the DJ area, and like cuts off the music, and
wait,
like it was
into your place,
like into our place, starts walking, like no one notices, and I'm from a distance seeing like this old lady in a robe storming through the apartment to the DJ area, and I'm like, whoa, like what happened? Like I thought we said like, you know, just tell us and we'll turn out. She's like, no, this is unacceptable, whatever. Cops came, gave us a citation, and then the next day like we had to talk with him. We're like, hey, so like we need to come to like some sort of understanding because this can't keep happening. And then basically like it was just an issue, to be honest, for like the entire year. Like we kind of just risked getting in trouble because like he was just not having it. Like I said, he had a newborn, so like
yeah,
he was being a big piece of shit about it, but whatever. So yeah, bro. Funny enough, there was a huge meme circulating about him for completely different reasons about like his class on the UCLA Facebook group.
Okay.
Like we have like a memes page.
Every school had that.
So there was like a meme circulating. We're all like, oh, that's funny, that's the neighbor, but like only like 10 people, only like we knew about it, but it was pretty funny.
And you're also you were pre-med in college too, right?
I was pre-med, yeah. I was a neuro major. Okay. I didn't like it, to be, I didn't like my major, to be honest. I didn't like the upper divs, but that was my fault. I didn't like properly like do my research about like what is this I just saw neuroscience. I was like, oh, that's sick, like, yeah, I get to learn about the brain
too. Yeah.
But it wasn't like neuro. And I took one neuroanatomy class, which was the human brain, which is what I wanted to study. That's what I thought was interesting. But other than that, all the other classes, it was very research based. So it was like professors who were doing some sort of research in neuroscience.
And they were like psychology?
No. It was like they had like PhDs in neuroscience. So they were just like doing research on like worms and like long-term potentiation and like memory and like snails.
Okay.
So like the way the major was set up, not to get like too into it, but you took like these three required classes, 101 A, B, and C. And each class had three professors. Every 3 weeks, you had a new professor, right?
Yeah.
So they call it a module. So like for 3 weeks, the professor would teach you whatever he felt like teaching you. Oh, so it wasn't really structured. So I don't feel like I learned, like,
yeah,
it was just like random, irrelevant, like unrelated things.
Yeah, that's weird.
It was weird. I didn't like it, to be honest. I hated it. Like, I'm not even gonna.
So they made their own tests on like they whatever, made their own, they
whatever they wanted.
So and you applied to med school.
I did apply to med school. Okay. Didn't get in my first cycle. I'm still unofficially on a wait list, but like I'm not.
Oh, FIU, right?
Yeah, FIU. Okay. They haven't gone back to me.
Cool.
I was on another wait list, the one in Chicago we were talking about. But I didn't get in, unfortunately.
Okay.
I'm reapplying this year. I think I have a better application. I have more like work experience.
Oh, for sure.
Something that I think was lacking.
Is that the school that you're gonna do the master's this year?
No, that's it. Okay. I'm potentially doing that master's. It's a different school in Chicago. The way it works is you get it's a master's in biomedical sciences. Mm-hmm. And then if you do well in the program, if you get A's and B's, you get an automatic interview to the med school.
Oh, wow.
And then whether you get in or not is kind of based on your interview.
Oh, that's sick.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then the only reason I'm considering it is the tuition for that program will substitute my first year tuition for med school if I go to that school. Yeah, so that's sick. Money.
That's right? Money right
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
Then there's no other like programs that do that around the country?
No. So FAU, I got into their thing, but they don't offer that like a linkage type thing. It's called a linkage where you go from. Yeah. They don't offer that. So I was just like, not bad.
Okay.
Yeah.
And your dad's a doctor. That's why you want to go into it, right?
No, my dad's not. It's funny. People think like everyone in my family is a doctor. I don't have one. There's not someone with like the Gomeshi last name that's a doctor.
In the world,
bro. I'll be the first. No, in my like immediate family. Maybe I have like some random like.
Yeah.
Cousin in Iran or some shit.
So why do you what interests you about medicine?
Honestly, like, I just think, so this is what happened. I read a book called Gifted Hands when I was like 10 by Ben Carson. He's like
Ben Carson.
A lot of people don't like him anymore because like he was the Republican.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But this was like way before. He was a neurosurgeon at the time.
Right.
And like he basically talked about how like he grew up in the projects of Detroit. And like he failed like elementary school and like his family like wasn't into like, you know, education and like working hard. And his mom basically made him like read a book every week, write a report on him, got him into like school because like for him, like school was his only outlet to like getting a better life. And like he worked hard and ended up like going to med school, he went to Hopkins, did neurosurgery. Wow. He did like the first ever twin separation surgery. Yeah, yeah, they have a movie on it. I don't remember what it's called. But, like, I just thought that was cool. Like, wow, like, anyone can, you know, do this. Like, if you just, like, work at it. It's not something that, like, you know, with sports, you kind of need, like genetics and, like, God-given gift to be, like, LeBron. But with this, it's, like, if you want it, you can do it. And, like, that's how I kind of look at things. Like, whatever you want to do, you can accomplish it if you just work hard enough. It's not something
like that,
that's, like, luck.
I agree with that.
Yeah, so that's one of the main reasons. And then another is... I think you just get to interact with a lot of different people, whether it's like patients or your coworkers, especially nowadays, like doctors are always communicating with nurses and PAs and like people with like business degrees on how to make healthcare better. So I think it's cool. I like to talk to people and like meet new people and get new ideas.
With the sports thing, I feel like it's not totally like genetics based.
No, it's not. But I think, okay, so here's my view on sports.
Yeah.
You can work 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, workout. You can follow LeBron's regimen.
Yeah.
Neither me or you will ever be LeBron.
Sure, for
because of genetics.
Yeah.
That's my point.
Okay, I agree.
Even NBA players, take the worst NBA player. We could do exactly what he does.
Yeah.
And we still won't be him.
But let's say, like, the worst NBA player right now, he probably did what LeBron did and worked just as hard.
Yeah.
And but he's just because of genetics, he's the worst and LeBron's the best.
Yeah, but he's relatively, that worst NBA player is top 1.001% of the entire planet.
Yeah, for sure.
But like within the NBA, there's levels.
And then when you max out genetics and you max out work ethic,
That's
you get Usain Bolt.
You get LeBron.
And people that just wipe out the competition.
Yeah, exactly. Like LeBron's like work ethic is insane. Like
Kobe Bryant.
Yeah, Kobe's, yeah. Exactly. So you can't, genetics can outplay work ethic to a certain degree.
Yeah.
And same thing, work ethic can outplay genetics to a certain degree. But I think you do need both.
To be the top.
Yeah,
top.
To be the top.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So that's why, that's like my view on sports.
Yeah. I actually applied to med school too. Like,
yeah. You were the only person, I had two other friends in LA, but they were like non-traditional students, 28, applying. You were the only like traditional, like out of, you know, undergrad applying to med school that I knew. So like,
yeah, I didn't know too many either. Yeah, I think we were in a weird year because most of my friends went right into, from undergrad to med school because they applied the summer after junior year.
Yeah. Wow,
then,
really?
Yeah, and then like the rest of my friends are applying now.
Okay.
And it's like no one applied that graduate.
Same with me. My I had one friend apply. He was a reapplicant last year. He didn't get it, unfortunately, this year. He's going to end up doing his PhD first.
Oh, yeah?
And then apply in a couple years. Okay. But yeah, so you were the only person that I really knew that was also applying.
The thing is, like, I wanted to be a doctor.
Yeah, what happened? Because I just remember randomly, because you troll all the time. So you were like, I'm not doing med school. I was like, oh, like, for sure, fuck you. Like, you're trolling, whatever. And then, like, you were serious about it. I was like, oh, wow, like, you went through all that.
Yeah.
And then it kind of, you finally realized, like, it's not really for you.
Yeah, dude, I was, like, obsessed with, like, society's view of doctors. I saw doctors as like not lavish lifestyles, but like ahead of the game, like respected,
prestigious,
making a lot of money, smart, talented. And I saw those things in being a doctor,
but you didn't see the hard part.
I didn't know. Well, not that I didn't care about liking the medicine.
That didn't bother
me. Like, I was good at my classes, like in undergrad.
Yeah, you killed UF.
I killed it, but like I didn't care for it, you know?
Wow.
It was more like
interesting. You never once like thought about it?
I loved the hustle of getting like good grades, of like just studying my ass off, and like I fell in love with that. And I thought like by extension that meant I loved what I was studying.
But you didn't at all.
Like,
but like you weren't really studying medicine in undergrad.
I was studying like biology.
Yeah, but like you're not even studying medicine until residency. That's like true. Even like most doctors say, I don't use anything except like my last year in residency.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
But I feel you. Like, it's smart that you made that decision, because I know a lot of students like realize that when they're in med school, when you're in too deep at that point. Like, you know.
I think what got me into like learning about medicine was working as a medical scribe
in,
like,
that's a great job. Medical assistants and scribes are the best jobs to figure out like what it is to be a doctor.
In my medical scribe job, I you know what a scribe is, right?
You
follow around
down
the doctors, and like it was in an emergency room.
Okay, so
ER. I was working like 40 doctors, like a different doctor.
But they were all ER doctors or different doctors?
All ER doctors.
Oh, yeah. So, but they were ER doctors. Like, that's what their type of doctor they were.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, when you go into the ER,
Meant, because you said, like, different types of doctors.
No,
so I thought you meant
40, like,
ER doctors.
Got it.
That's a sick, like, job.
Yeah. Well, that's what I thought. And then, like, I saw what they were doing, and, like, they were not my vision of a doctor. It was, like, that, like, okay, honestly, most of them didn't like their job. I would ask around.
Most doctors don't.
Yeah.
My personal statement was about a doctor who told me not to be a doctor.
Yeah, dude. So annoying. Like, I hate when people like just like
say that.
Yeah.
The medical assistant I worked for, he's the definition of the prestige and the power and the money. He drives a Lambo.
Oh yeah.
But like that's not the reason, you know. I just like to put it in perspective. Like, he has money.
Yeah.
Bro, but like he has his own practice. He developed this new like treatment for cancer. It's basically called forgot what it was called, precision oncology. So the way it works is, and it's kind of intuitive, I'm surprised it took so long for these people to think of it. He doesn't treat cancer based on the type of cancer you have, bladder cancer, breast cancer. He does blood tests and genetic analysis of mutations in your tumors in blood.
Oh my god.
And then based on that, these pharmaceutical companies match the mutations with the chemo. So he'll give, it's called off-labeling treatment. So he'll give like bladder chemo, traditional bladder chemo for someone who has like breast cancer, right? And it's called precision oncology and it works. Like I've seen it. Like I see the blood test. You just see like high, then low. And you're like, holy and like quality of life. Like they're, I seen like this one dude, he had a tumor like up to here. Within a month, it was like normal.
That's sick.
It was crazy. And like he loved his job, bro. Like he'd have pharmaceutical companies come during lunch and they would get us free lunch every day. Oh. And like he was like, he ran it. Like he was the king of his field. So I think if you do it right.
But no, but dude, like my point is like, even like him driving a Lambo, him being like this power guy people go to seek help or whatever.
Yeah.
That's like a societal like standard of success. And I kind of like looked at like what do
I disagree with that personally.
Oh yeah, you think it's personal success?
I think it's a personal. I think success is what you think what's successful. Of course. It shouldn't matter what like society thinks is successful or not.
I agree with you. Yeah, that's what I didn't realize. Okay, like I thought like
because a lot of people think he's a crook. They think what he does is like you're just doing this to make money, but like it's not that. So people are always gonna have like their views on you, good and bad. Sure, so like in my opinion, and it took me a while to realize that, like I don't really let what other people like say like affect my opinion.
I was always about that, like I'm gonna do my own thing, and like I convinced myself that driving a Lambo
would make you
being
happy.
Super cool, like I'm the doctor of the neighborhood or whatever, like I thought that was successful.
Those are all secondary things. At the end of the day, you have to like medicine.
Course.
You have to like whatever you're doing to be good. Like you can't be good at something if you don't like it. Like it's, in my opinion, it's impossible because like you'll just be miserable.
Exactly. Yeah. So it took me a bit to realize that, and now I'm at the stage where like I'll be like a garbage man if it's what I love.
If you what you like,
it doesn't matter. And like honestly, money, like income, salary is only one source of income.
Exactly. Exactly.
You can make investing income from you can you got to invest your money. Like you could live so cheaply and just like. Make like 20 grand a year and live off of like 5 grand a year which is like insanely cheap.
That is insanely cheap,
but like you can invest the rest
and you gotta invest. You have to invest if you want to make money, especially nowadays. Your salary is not going to cut it regardless of what you do. You got to do stocks, you got to do real estate
and different streams of income, like
like my dad's been trying to get me into like like understanding like principles of investing.
Oh, and,
like,
how, have you invested anything?
I have so I do a little bit of stock market stuff, nothing crazy, just like I have like some money in different stocks and I try to keep up with like what's going up and down, get like the basics down before.
Do you like day trade?
I wouldn't call myself no I don't day trade. I kind of just keep it there, and then like every 6 months I'll look. If it goes up, I'll sell it. If it doesn't, I'll keep
so
it.
You like individual stocks?
Yeah, I do individual stocks, exactly. Okay. Like I have stock in Microsoft. My brother works there.
You get a deal on this stock?
No, he does, not me. Okay. Yeah.
What does he get, like half off?
Well, like no. The way I don't really know the specifics of it, but he gets salary, he gets a bonus, and he also gets stock.
Oh, he gets paid in stock.
He gets paid in stock.
That's cool.
So, fun fact: like 6 months ago, from the first day he started working, which I think was 2015, 6 months ago, it like officially doubled the stock. So I thought that was cool, like good for him.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Is he gonna sell it?
No. I think he sold some of it, but I mean, it's all about like knowing, never like.
I would sell it to get the money back and then just like.
But like, it's gonna continue going up.
You don't know that.
Okay, so it's like the way I look at it, and it's also based on like the way my dad looks at it, because like he's the one person that like he's like been successful.
What is he?
He's a businessman. So right now.
He works in a bank, though.
No,
right?
So he does work at a bank. He does. He sells loans.
Okay.
So, basically, he knows. Part of his job is just knowing a lot of people. So his job consists of being on the phone, and just like connecting like really wealthy guys with other wealthy guys, and like having like person A give like a $300,000 loan to person B, and that person B will pay him back plus interest. That's what he does. He brings business to the bank.
Okay.
That's his new job.
Sure.
Yeah.
That's sick.
Yeah.
So what's his like ideas on like individual stocks?
Yeah, that's what individual stocks is, like long term, long, like slow and steady always wins the race. Never get too
excited. You should invest in low cost index funds.
Yeah, he does low cost index funds. But he does mainly like Apple. He has stock in like Microsoft, like those big companies.
Yeah.
But he doesn't like go crazy. So like. He has a lot of money in the stocks, but like he kind of feels it out. Of course, like he loses every now, like coronavirus kind of like everything.
Well, you don't lose unless you take it out.
Exactly, but like, no, well, so when you say the word lose, you're right, but you could be losing, which means like your stock went down. So like if you were to sell it,
yeah, but that's when you buy. That's when you buy more stock.
No, so like let's say I buy stock. Let's say I buy stock today, $100 a stock. Just okay. Right. Then let's say in a week it's $95. I'm losing. I lost $5.
You didn't lose it though.
You haven't lost it, but you're losing. Like you're in. Like
I
you're
guess,
in.
The... But like that's a terrible way to think about it. If you're doing long term.
Exactly. No. That's why you do long term. Okay, that's right. You're making my point. That's why you do long term. You don't look at it in a week. Because if you look at it in a week, you just lost $5, but you have it.
Yeah.
But like stocks don't go down by $5 in a week. Now you have to compound that by like 6 months. If you're down by five, that's fine. Hold it, it'll go back up. Right. That's kind of what I mean by long term.
You know what I'm doing? I got a Roth IRA in 2019.
I don't know what that is.
It's a account where you could invest in stocks and take it out without being taxed. Like it doesn't get taxed on the way out. I think it gets taxed on the way in, but not on the way out.
And what do you mean on the way in? Like, so like I buy $100 stock, it costs me $120 with tax.
Yeah, I think something like that. Don't quote
me. The amount that you purchase that they charge you is more than the amount of stock you own. You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so.
So like when you buy $90 shoes, the shoes are worth $90, but you have to spend $100.
Yeah, I think it's like that. Like that? And then like it's not taxed on the way out because on the way out, like let's say that stock went up to $200. You'll get that 200. You won't get like 175 or 160, whatever it is.
But do other stock, they do?
Yeah, you always get taxed on the way out.
Because I do through Wells Fargo.
Yeah, you're getting taxed on the way out.
Okay, I'll look into
that. So Roth
IRA? IRAs,
yeah, and it's like a really good deal, so they cap it. If you're making a certain amount of income, like if you're making the lowest amount of income, you can't invest more than $6,000 per year.
That's it?
Yeah. Cause it's tax free basically, okay. So I mean you can open up other accounts.
Got it.
So what I've been doing is I opened up a Roth IRA in 2019. I've been maxing it out since, so I have like 12K in it, and I've been following low cost index fund S&P 500. So I've invested in a stock that follows that. So I'm just trying to ride that out until like for like 40 years and just keep maxing it out like every year.
How much you make 12 a year right now?
No.
I'm sorry, I'm a little confused. So how much what are you profiting right now, would you say? Like what are you making?
From the stocks?
Yeah.
I'm not making anything because I didn't take anything out.
Okay, so like when I asked that, if you were to take it out right now.
I mean I invested $6K in like December of 2019.
And what is it at right now? You said 12?
No. I invested another $6K in 2020.
Okay. So what's it worth right now?
I don't even look at it, honestly.
Okay.
I don't care.
You don't care.
I just, as soon as the market dips, like it did in March, you want to just shove money into
that. Yeah, you just shove money into
that. Yeah, but don't take anything out.
Of course. Yeah.
So
when do you plan on taking it out?
Okay, so the S&P 500, historically, ever since its conception in like, I don't know when it started, like the early 1900s, it's been profiting about 10% on average returns, which is good. And people like try to beat the market. That is the market. S&P 500 is the top 500 biggest companies. So 10% return on average. So if I keep putting in $6,000 a year into that stock that follows S&P 500, in like 30 years, it'll come back to like $1.3 million.
Holy shit.
And like after only putting in like six times 30.
180?
Yeah.
Wow, that's good.
Yeah.
Good.
So it's all about compounding interest.
It is compound interest.
Yeah. I don't mess with small stocks. I don't mess with individual stocks. Because you never know.
What do you mean by individual stocks?
Like Microsoft, okay. Apple. I mean, they're. If you're going to invest in individual stocks, those are the ones to invest in.
Yeah, that's right.
But like, I wouldn't even like mess with that. I would just like...
Low-cost index funds
or like NASDAQ.
NASDAQ, okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough. What's your opinion on real estate?
I read a book on real estate recently.
Yeah, that's where like... But you have to have... Like, that's where the real money is, but you have to have enough money to invest in real estate.
For sure, yeah. The worst thing you want to do is take out loans.
Yeah.
That's the worst thing.
Like, my dad and his brothers, like, that's what they, when they were young, like, when they were my age, rather than, like, spending their money on, like, they would go buy tiny apartments. And, like, they have apartments all over Weston.
Oh, that's sick.
And now they're just, like, you know, racking in money by people who, like, purchase those apartments. Like,
because what happens is, like, real estate tends to appreciate.
Yeah.
And you get rents.
Exactly.
So that makes up for the mortgage that you took out. Or if you paid it in full and don't have a mortgage, that's just income right there.
So what my dad did to my older brother, he made him buy a house. And the reason was is, like, he works at Microsoft, so he was making, like, you know, good money for his age, right? Sure. And he was spending, you know, he wasn't saving it. He was spending, you know, more than what we thought he should be spending.
Okay.
And the reason was is he had a lot of disposable income. So, like, after rent, after...
Yeah.
Bills, he was, you know, he had some money to do whatever he wanted, buy some shoes, go out.
Yeah.
So my dad was like, you need to save it. And he wasn't listening. So what he did is, like, buy this house, like, in Seattle, live in it. It'll appreciate. The house, the mortgage on the house is so much that he doesn't have a lot of disposable income now. So even if he wanted to go buy something, he really couldn't. But the thing is the money that he's putting in into that house is going to go up in like 5-6 years, and he's going to make, like, you know, let's say $300,000-$400,000.
What he could do, your brother, is buy like a duplex, like an apartment duplex.
Right now he's strapped on that house.
Yeah.
He pays like that monthly thing.
But this is what I learned, that what I'm gonna do when I actually, like, have disposable income, to just, like, pay in full, like, buy the whole property, like, in full, like, no mortgage, no loans.
Yeah.
So
that's the move.
That's the move for sure.
But, like, you gotta have enough money for that.
For sure, like, you have to save up like at least 100K.
Yeah, to,
like,
easy.
Get like a decent duplex.
And then rent it out.
Yeah, and then rent it out, like
you'll be a landlord.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about.
And then their rent goes to you, and you're living for free, basically, and probably property.
You gotta live somewhere else.
You can live with them. What are you talking about? People like buy
in the same
their,
unit.
Yeah, dude. People buy their apartments, and then rent out the other room.
Oh, okay. You're talking about something different.
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about, like, you buy, like, a unit and you rent out that unit.
That too, yeah. You can do that too.
Yeah. I'm not trying to live with, like, I just personally don't like that, like, live with random.
With your tenants?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It just makes things complicated.
Well, I mean, it depends if they're, like, friends, like.
Bro, I would never mix friends and business. Things get complicated.
I mean, they're paying for rent anyway.
What if they're like, oh, bro, you're my homie, can you, like, spot me an extra month?
No, would you
That's
be able to
happens,
do
that?
Would you
that
be able to
happens,
do that if you
bro.
Had a regular apartment?
That happens. Like, yo, like, can I have an extra week? Like, money's tight.
I guess, yeah.
Can you knock off 200 next month, please?
Yeah.
That happens, man. That happens all the time.
I know, yeah. I guess you're right.
Careful.
It could, I mean, it depends if you have, like, weird friends that do that.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not just, like, People are weird, like, in general, so, like,
that's another
things
thing.
Happen.
You gotta, like, background check your tenants.
Yeah,
like,
for sure, bro.
Because, like, they could just ruin the house and shit.
I have a great story to tell you. So, you know Navid, right, my cousin?
Yeah.
He had a roommate in his UF. They had, like, an apartment or whatever, like, a house, I don't know, like...
Yeah, yeah.
With, like, 8 people.
Sure, probably, like, a house, right?
Yeah. So I guess that's common in Gainesville, like, people do that.
Yeah.
In LA, you obviously can't do that.
Disgusting.
Yeah. So he had this one guy, I don't know, we don't need to say his name or anything, but
say it.
I don't even remember his name. I met him a couple of times, but he wasn't paying rent, like, at all.
Jeez.
So, like, the other tenants, they weren't really getting that, because when they signed the contract, and this is what I did when I got mine, like, we specifically told the landlord, like, I am responsible for them. So, like, you want me up if I don't pay my rent, you can do that.
Yeah.
So the landlords came to the house, they were like, and put a lock on his door and, like, took everything he had, and, like, he disappeared. It was bad, dude. It got, like, really bad. Like, he, like, disappeared, went AWOL, because, like, he just wasn't paying rent.
But yeah, it's risky.
And, like, bro, this was, like, a guy they met in college, thought he was, like, a sick guy. Like, they were, like, one of his roommates was, like, childhood friends with this person. So, like, you never know. Like, when it comes with, like, money, things get, like, a little weird.
Yeah.
So you just gotta be careful with who you trust and stuff.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
I was gonna ask you, so, like, what's your, like, long-term plan right now? Like, you're trying to do your psych thing?
Yeah, yeah. So,
get your degree, master's?
Yeah, so I'm trying to get a job as an RBT, a registered behavioral technician. So I reached out to my friend who's actually, like, a BCABA, which is, like, the person in charge of the RBTs. So basically I'm trying to...
Be an RBT.
Be an RBT who...
they go to houses and like help children with on the autism spectrum.
Oh, nice. I
like that. With behavioral issues.
Okay.
So I feel like that's very a rewarding thing to do.
That's a great experience.
I'm interested in like the mental health field.
Yeah, me too. Honestly, yeah. Me too.
So yeah, so I started looking into like social work, like things like that, and then I found this RBT thing.
And then after like so okay, so
and then at, okay,
yeah,
and
like, what's like your to, ultimate like I'm also trying to, like in 10 years where do you see yourself kind of thing? Like what do you want to do eventually?
I feel you, dude. I'm trying to be a clinical psychologist to get a
clinical
PhD.
Psychology. So you'd have to get a PhD for that, or can you do it with a master's?
But you want your PhD called. I don't know if it's called something different, but you could definitely be a like Dang. A psychologist.
But you want your PhD in clinical psychology.
Yeah.
So you want to go to PhD school and get your PhD in clinical, like that's overall what you want to do.
Yeah, yeah.
Sick.
Yeah. So I want this PhD specifically. Like I used to do things for like, oh, like I want to be like making money, blah blah blah.
No,
I don't care about this
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah.
I need the PhD for like I want to be a professor. I want
oh,
to do
shit.
Research.
I want to be a professor too. I want to be a professor out of med school.
Bro, being a professor, I used to teach biochemistry. So I taught like a class of like 20, 25 students. And dude, that was like a highlight of my college
one of,
career.
Yeah, one sure. of my neuro professors, I was talking about those modules every 3 weeks. He was a professor at UCLA Med School. And he taught us his module, and he was just, it was like the most interesting module because it was like literally like medical neuroscience. Like how does like what we're learning relate to like helping patients, which is yeah. what I want to do.
Yeah.
And like, that's like my goal. Like if you're whatever kind of doctor I am, if I do, I don't think I'll be a researcher, but most doctors do some type of research.
Sure, yeah.
And then I want to go and like teach that to a bunch of like 20-year-olds and be like,
sick.
If I help one student, like inspire one kid to like go do something like that, I'd be like, like did something good.
That's sick. I feel like that's like, I don't know, I feel like that's like a very rewarding thing
yeah.
to do, just like teaching people.
Most like 95% of them are gonna be like, oh man, like that midterm was hard, oh
yeah,
man, like
I'm not caring.
Yeah, so, like, yeah, but like there's like one or two like, kids who are like, oh wow, like I actually like
yeah
that professor
yeah.
And it's like that's what I think that's what like keeps professors going, because they have a tough job
for sure. Well,
being a professor is not easy, because like if you don't have tenure. Because I was pretty close to one of my OCAM professors at UCLA. He didn't have tenure at UCLA.
You're not making much.
And, like, in UCLA's quarter system, so, like, every quarter, they could just tell him, like, sorry, like, we don't have, like, a
yeah.
lecture for you to teach.
Yeah.
And then you don't have a job. Like, you don't
yeah.
have... All of a sudden, like, you don't have anything. So,
yeah.
like, it's, like... It's pretty, like, I would say inspirational that,
yeah,
like, they, like, do
sure.
that stuff.
And the third thing I want to do is, like, be that clinical psychologist, like, have my own practice.
Okay, so how does that work? You like, see patients
yeah.
who, like, have whatever, like, diseases,
yeah, yeah,
illnesses,
yeah.
and then you just, like, do... You can't prescribe medicine. I'm
no,
on,
no.
As a
you
kind of
just, like, work through their problems with, like...
Speaking and, like, different therapies?
Yeah, just therapy, pretty much.
So the only thing you can't prescribe, like, pharmaceuticals, like, medicine.
I don't even know the extent. I think they're changing it recently.
Okay.
Like,
what's your opinion on those for treatment?
What, pharmaceuticals?
Like, antidepressants and, like, neuroleptics, like that.
I don't have a strong opinion on. I mean, if
like,
it works.
Are you anti them or not?
No.
Okay.
I mean, if it's like dangerous, if you're getting addicted and like you can't survive without like the drugs, then it's like.
Because a lot of people are against them. And the way I look at it is like, there are some people who are functional citizens of this country and like have a, I guess, quote unquote, whatever you consider a normal life because of like, you know, continuous
yeah.
normal use of
yeah,
like,
for sure. yeah.
which is like, so that kind of bothers me when people say like, oh, like, medicine
no,
like doctors
dude,
don't know what they're
I
talking
mean, as long as it
or, like,
doesn't take over your life
yeah.
like I feel like as long as like drugs isn't a problem
yeah,
for you
yeah
then you're
it,
fine.
It enhance I don't consider them drugs really, like they enhance your life, like for example people say like oh Adderall is like horrible and it's like
oh yeah
there
yeah.
are like some kids like 10-year-olds who like need a little
yeah,
bit of Adderall
yeah.
to like focus in
yeah,
school
yeah.
like how are you gonna say
yeah.
just because it makes you feel like shit well maybe you don't need Adderall
yeah
you know
no,
what I mean
no. I feel like they're probably referring to the people that actually like abuse it
yeah
I think any type of like drug abuse
yeah
bad.
Anything drugs of abuse like abusing them is obviously wrong but
sure.
like they all exist like I like what I'm basically trying to get at is people say like oh we should just eradicate them completely and it's like,
I don't know anybody who's ever said
really?
That eradicate drugs in
yeah
general.
What wow care. Dude especially with like the whole marijuana thing like oh like weed cures everything like we don't need like Xanax and
oh,
Prozac
those people are
yeah
doing
dude yeah
the people that are pro weed
yeah
are saying,
man
like let's get
Joe,
rid of
your boy Joe Rogan for example
he's
have you
not
ever,
like against
dude
presence
have you
like
heard
that.
His on
weed, oh my god. Don't get me wrong, like I don't think weed is bad at all. Like like if you want to smoke weed, do it.
Sure.
But like he sits there and says like there is nothing wrong with weed, and I'm like, bro, I've seen people's lives, like my homies, do nothing with their life because of weed. So don't tell me there's nothing wrong with weed. There's
definitely like people that take things to the extreme.
Yeah, I mean, man.
If you could have like a broccoli addiction and like broccoli can mess you up.
Exactly.
But like
weed, anything in excess is bad for you.
Yeah. Honestly, if you're breathing in anything other than air, it's not good for you in general. Yeah. So people don't realize that weed actually causes cancer.
No, I want to say weed causes cancer. There might be a correlation between smoking, the act of smoking anything, and developing cancer, but that's exactly not a causation. Oh. You can't say causation.
Oh, okay. So eating weed, probably, I don't know.
Eating weed is probably way, we can't say causation. Yeah, anything. We gotta say correlation.
Okay, but inhaling smoke in general,
correlation with cancer. I mean, I know what you're talking about, because literally every single cancer patient had a hit, like when I would look through their history, did you smoke? Yes.
Yeah, right.
And it was like, we're talking like 20, 30 cigarettes a day.
Yeah. So do you think, cigarettes cause cancer?
I don't like to use the word cause.
Okay, you just like correlations.
I mean, I think that's the right way to look at it. Especially in the real world, A never causes B. There's so many other things.
Because
there are people who, sorry to interrupt you. There are people who smoke daily, never get cancer.
Okay.
So therefore you can't say smoking. Then there's people people who have never smoked or drink or do anything like that a day in their life, and they can have stage 5 cancer, they're gonna die next week. So it happens all the time.
So what would you think is one thing in this world that does cause something else? You think nothing causes anything?
One thing that causes something else.
You'd
have to simplify it to
can
like,
something cause something, or just nothing causes anything? Is that what you're getting
at? So like, okay, I mean, you want to talk about it as far as like, let's see.
I don't know, I'm just testing your philosophy here.
Okay, so whatever the artery is that connects to your brain, if I cut that artery, that will cause you to die.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So, like, if you simplify it to that level,
there's not, like... When you're looking at research, like, I agree.
Most researchers, they never use the word causation. Because I took a class on this. It's actually one of my favorite classes. We would, like, rip apart research papers, and that's when I kind of got, like, a little interested in it, and I understood what research meant. And, like, if you saw the word causation, my professor would just, like, big red X, get the... out of here, because it's true. Because you can't say that.
Yeah.
Not one experiment. You can do a billion experiments, but like you can't. But the real world isn't like that, where it's so simple that like A causes B. Like if you get in a car accident and it causes your death, you can't say the car accident caused your death.
Yeah.
What if you weren't wearing a seatbelt? What if like, I don't know, there just happened to be like a tree next to you, and the tree cut like went into your thing?
Yeah.
Did the tree cause your death, or did the car accident?
Can it be a combination?
Exactly. But if it's a combination of them, you can't say like. That's why one thing has a correlation with another thing, because it's a combination of that one thing with that other one thing, and that other one thing has a correlation with that one thing. Does that make sense or no?
Yeah.
So like when you say like confounding variables, those are the other things.
Yeah.
But each individual variable has a correlation with like that end result.
Okay.
That's what I'm trying to say.
I see you. I like it. That's more of like a philosophical like standpoint on it.
Yeah. Which I think applies to like everything in life. Like you could say like, I don't know. You go to a grocery store and you want to like find the fastest way to like check out. Are you going to like buy less things today and then like go tomorrow and save time, or you know what I mean? Like there's just like a lot of different ways you can just look.